Right, welcome along to the last session between me, or you, and Movie World. Last year, I think I got the Friday morning 8:15 slot, which was after you and the party, so I'm just get all the lucky things. So, my name's Anthony Boughton. I'm here to talk to you about cloud-based load testing using the TIM Foundation service. I have this bad habit of pressing the wrong button on this thing, or not pressing the button on this thing. It does work, that's good. So for those of you that don't know me, that's a little bit about me. I'm a Visual Studio ALM MVP. I've been a Microsoft Certified Trainer for a while and a Microsoft Certified Professional for the last 20 years. So that goes back just a little ways. So I was in Brisbane doing my first Microsoft exam at around the same time they ran their very first tech ed in the country. Got an email address up there, that helps me remember where I am. So I did 236 days on the road last year, so I get to travel around a lot and talk about ALM best practices and teach people how to use the TFS tooling. So I got back from the US on Saturday, so I'm still getting up at 4 in the morning and wanting to go to bed at about 8 at night. That's really embarrassing. So the agenda. We're going to talk about, do we need to do load testing? Kind of thinking you know the answer because you're here to learn about it. Oh, up the front, this is awesome. No one comes up the front and volunteers for all the hard questions. Excellent. We're going to talk about the challenges with load testing. Actually, the prize is a ticket to Movie World tonight. You get the question right? I'm really cheap. We're going to talk about the challenges of load testing. In fact, I reckon you guys are going to tell me about the challenges of load testing. We're going to have a look at a lap around the load testing today. Interestingly, that takes up a disproportionate amount of the agenda, which is both good and bad. Good because you may not be that familiar with it already. Bad because you want to see the sexy new stuff. Well, that's really easy. That's really simple for me to show you at the end. So I think, what, just skip to that and you guys can be at the front of the queue. You going to vote for that option? Excellent, man after my own heart, I like it. And then Q&A, who am I kidding? It's like, I'm done. The room empties, that's what I'm expecting to see this afternoon. So, do we need load testing? Who's using web performance tests today in Visual Studio? Alrighty, now you know why we do that thing, a lap around Visual Studio load testing today. So we're going to have a good close look at that. Why do we need it? Who as a consumer, as a user of a system, has seen a really good fail because of load? Has anyone had a first-hand experience? Excellent. Was it your system?
No.
Excellent. Yeah. Who was responsible for the failure? Yeah, no one's going to put their hand up. It's just not going to happen. The problem is there's just so many choices for ones I can pick. But of course, in the Australian audience, one of the ones that I do like to choose, of course, is this one. These guys gave me so much to work with. Now, guys, I'm not poking fun at them for a second, not at all. I'm feeling for the company. They sort of anticipated some big numbers, 1 million users. We don't normally get that kind of volume, not your average Aussie site. They expected that load over 24 hours, and they got it over a couple of minutes. That's always going to hurt. And even reaching those kind of numbers for any form of load testing is a big investment. So again, not for a minute having a go, but really feeling for that kind of challenge. If you look at some of the results, ouch. And I've chosen some of the more friendly comments and social feedback that I could find up there. But I'd like to ask the question, with the experience they had, like, couple of million people in the first couple of minutes, do you think they will easily get that demand back again? I wouldn't think so. Do you know that they're still running events? Did anyone know that? Did anyone know they had a big promotion for Father's Day? No. So sometimes you only get one shot of making a first impression, and look at that for a first impression. We don't want that to be our sites. I wouldn't want that to be my site anyway. So, a few terms just to kick us off. Don't worry about the little writing. The little writing's horrible. That kicks me out of trainer school every time. But in terms of getting the presentation, looking at the videos afterwards, there's some information there if you want it. But some terminology. So web performance and load testing, or just load testing. Firstly, I want to talk about performance testing. Just four terms. The key thing there, designed to eliminate bottlenecks and establish a baseline. So we really want that. We want a baseline. We want to know, are we improving? Are we getting worse? Some of our goals there, we want to validate responsiveness. We want to look at reliability and scalability. Okay, perf testing. The next one we want to have a look at is load testing. So load testing is all about real-world load. Okay? So we want to have a look at things like compare with the baseline. We want to have a look at finding some bugs and issues that just cursory testing won't uncover. So let's get some real-world load, push it towards the system, and see what comes out of it. We're looking for things like memory leaks, buffer overruns, going and putting things like a nice sustained load against a site, and then seeing what happens to all the counters, seeing that memory's creeping up without a corresponding increase in load. Well, there's an obvious problem for us to consider. Ooh, click frenzy. Sorry, no pun intended. Stress testing. So stress testing, it's the fun one. That's when we try and break stuff. So stress testing is load testing done under extreme or non-typical loads. It's, you know, the one we think about is let's push as much load towards this site as we possibly can until smoke comes out of the server. Why do we think of that one? Because it's fun. But it's more than that. It's about, does our site gracefully recover? Stuff happens. Probably not the best place to stand. So stuff happens. Things unexpected come around the corner all the time. So we want to make sure that our site under extreme load can handle things, but it's also about just pulling things out. Just disconnecting the cable from the network server or just taking the virtual NIC offline, bringing it back again. How does it recover from those kinds of things? So stress testing is really quite a lot in that area. And then finally, capacity and scale testing. So we want to look at both scale up and scale out scenarios there. Potentially also geographic distribution. So maybe we're a great little Aussie startup, we're doing some really good work here, and we're expecting growth, but not just growth from within Australia. We want growth across four geos that we're going to go into. So how's that look for the application? So there's a few different scenarios there. Some of the challenges, I said I was going to get you guys to tell me that, so I'm going to hide that little thing. It was a hint. I like to walk around, the room doesn't like me walking around. So who's going to volunteer? What's one of the challenges you face with load testing today? Go for it.
Getting enough servers.
Getting enough servers. Servers are cheap. Yeah, right. What else?
Estimating load.
Oh, that's a good one. That's a hard one too, isn't it? So, I mean, again, let's pick our friends at Click Frenzy. They didn't for a moment expect or anticipate that, and you can't hold that against them. Okay? Hindsight's wonderful, and there's been a lot of people come out afterwards saying they should have anticipated it. Yeah, okay. Hindsight's always good like that. Something else?
Load generators.
The load generators. Okay. A little bit more?
Well, they have to be targeted at what you're trying to put on the load.
Mm-hmm. So I guess that's more about a discipline and practice, understanding the types of uses that are going on against the system and be able to generate some form of realistic load. And then having the insight into the application and usage patterns to say that people aren't just clicking along browsing every day. They're doing all sorts of things to the site, and we want to be able to replicate and simulate that. Now, again, history's good for that. If we can look back a year, well, that's okay, but when you haven't got that history to start with, well, it is, you know, a lot more risky. So some of the things that I've got up here today. Provisioning is complex, and getting the servers, certainly a challenge, but it's not just the acquisition of them. It's the various teams that are involved. So if I wanted to go and set up a good test rig for load testing, I'm going to need to talk to procurement. They're going to need to go and get the servers. My IT folk are going to need to go and rack them and get them all set up and installed. Then we've got to go and do all the work. And often that's involving multiple different teams. And that's just red tape. That's just lead time. Okay, so getting the thing set up in the first place in an organization can be very, very challenging. Slow to scale. So if we go in there and we set up infrastructure for 10,000 concurrent virtual users, and we're going along there and life's good, and the management go, actually, we want 20,000. What are you going to do to sort of double that load? Well, potentially, you've got to go out, buy twice as many servers, get them, get them installed, get them set up, get them put into the controller configuration, and that's going to take, I don't know, let's call it a week. You know, if you've got to get on the phone, get your supply, they've got to have stock of the servers that you've got there, you've got to get them delivered, get them racked, all those sorts of things. It's a week to increase the size of the load we can generate. And it's expensive to create, but also to maintain it. How often do we do load testing? Is it like CI? Every time we check in, let's do load testing. Does anyone do that? There is some little benefit there, but not really. Load testing is usually done far less frequently, usually after stuff breaks. Oh, I wish we had done it. Let's do it now. When should you load test in a delivery cycle? Once per release. When? Before you release? Okay. I'll take that. Any other opinions? Feature complete? Okay. I like that. Anyone else?
As often as you can.
Ooh, I like that. As often as you can. More, the more the merrier? Yeah. So let's start at, you know, if it's a six-month release cycle, let's do it in the middle and build up towards that feature complete. That said, to have all of that test rig sitting around doing nothing for potentially months at a time isn't very palatable to management. They don't like having those things sit there, and then suddenly we turn them all on and you've got to catch up with 6 months' worth of updates. That's always going to be a load of fun, isn't it? So there's another big problem. Expensive to set up, expensive to have sitting around, expensive to maintain. Some of the typical problems we've got. All right. So I want to go through a lap around the load testing tools. Got to stop standing just there. Around the load testing tools in Visual Studio today. Another horrible, nasty slide, but I do only want to call out one thing on it. A little pointer. Does that work? Okay, cool. Okay, so the interesting thing on the slide here is Visual Studio Ultimate is where we find web performance and load testing. That's just the way it is. So with all of the stuff that you see up there, all the different versions, the interesting thing is the features I'm about to show you are only found in the Ultimate products queue. Ooh, this one went sleepies. Try that again. So I don't remember putting those transitions there. I think that's enough talking. Let's have a look at it. So I'm going to switch across to number two. And what you're looking at here is the preview build of Visual Studio 2013 that came out around the build time frame. Okay, so this is stuff you can get today and use. Although virtually everything I show you in this demonstration is exactly the same in 2012. And very similar in 2010. Okay, so what I'm going to do is go up here and say File, New Project. We'll go ahead and choose a language, and we want a test type and web performance and load testing, and wherever it wants to put it's fine. So we're going to use that default template that's in there. What it's going to do for us is it's going to create the solution, create a project for us, and automatically create our first web performance test. Okay? In previous versions, it wasn't called a web performance test. In fact, if you go right back to when we had the VSTS acronyms, when we had Visual Studio Team Edition for Software Testers, there was a nice big title. This thing was there. Back then, it was called a web test. Now it's known as a web performance test. The name changed. Not a lot else, but it was a significant change. Web test was a very broad, you know, type of test. Well, sorry, let me say that again. Web test could be interpreted to be all manner of test types. When coded UI turned up on the scene in 2010, then we had something that was really good for functional testing of web applications. So then this one was earmarked for what it's really good at, and that's the performance side of things. So the web performance test. Who's ever created a coded UI test? Anyone? So coded UI is about driving through the browser, navigating the DOM, finding the objects, clicking on things, grabbing properties back, interrogating them, making sure that the grand total in the shopping cart's the right thing, or whatever other type of test you want to do. So it drives the browser. This is very different. The browser's a horrible limiting factor when we want to try and do things. Great for humans, not great for any form of load testing. So web performance tests work at the network level. Okay, so we're way down the bottom, and the benefit of that is we can spin up lots more of them in memory. Having to spin up lots of browser instances, not great for the resources on the system. So I'm going to go ahead and simply click record. Yeah, why not? And what you see here is the browser I said we don't use. Well, not quite. So we're going to use the browser as a way of hosting our web test recorder. Now this is going to record everything we're going to do. I'm going to go in here to the demo music store application. Okay, nice simple little application there. And over here, it's recorded the request. I'm going to come down and click on disco. Now it didn't care that I clicked on disco. It didn't care what object type that was. It didn't care so much for the click. What it cared about was that we sent something back to the server to indicate that disco was the particular style of music we're interested in. And if we pop over here and have a look, you'll see what we recorded was the request, and there's a query string parameter going across there called genre equals disco. That's what we really cared about. Okay, so very different to coded UI. I'm going to continue browsing around. Let's have a look at Le Freak. Okay, that's fine. We'll go and have a browse in there. I might go up here and choose to insert a comment. Now that's good just to help understand, particularly if we're going in there and the page name stays the same, but we're just changing some parameters. So putting a little comment into the recording, moving on to, let's go into reggae next. It's simply going to, in our test results, output that string at that particular point. So it just helps us later on. We're paying it forward a little bit, putting the extra effort in now, that's going to make things a lot easier for us a little later on. I'm going to continue then, so let's go into reggae. Have a look at the greatest hits. Jump over to rock. So we're just doing some browsing there. When I'm done, I'll go ahead and stop the recording. And there's the web test created. So one of the biggest challenges there, well, that's going in identifying any dynamic parameters, things like session IDs and so forth. So one of the biggest challenges we've got is now we've got to record a range of these tests to simulate what people are doing on our site. When I teach a course on this, and one of the things I like to do is use an example of just Amazon. Guys, you guys probably all know about Amazon.com. You know, it's an e-commerce site. It's reasonably big, I hear. You're all doing something different on Amazon. You're not buying a book, please. And you're not buying, a mouse. That's the same. So I'm going to choose some volunteers. Do you like the way I say that? And my volunteers are all doing different things on Amazon. You look like you're a volunteer, sir. What are you doing on the Amazon site?
What do I find?
The first guy's always the hardest. It really is. I feel for you. I'm putting you on the spot. He's thinking, there goes his evals.
Well, sometimes use just cables. Like HDMI or something.
Did you just say you're buying a cable? I said, you can't buy a book or a mouse, and you just said cable. Fail. This side of the room is going to inspire me. Sir, what are you doing on Amazon?
Checking for specials.
Woohoo! Okay, see how he made it look easy. Fail. Anyway, I'm just going to get a punch tonight at the party. I'm just going to be walking along and just out of the blue. Oh, putting your head down so that we can't make eye contact never works. Never works. He won't ask me. What are you doing? Oh, taking a sip of coffee. He's trying them all.
How are you doing?
Oh, cop out. That's great. What are you doing on Amazon? Oh, education books. Back over here. That's another fail. All right, what are you doing over there, sir?
Comparing prices.
Comparing prices. Okay, I'm happy with that. Keep going.
I'm doing a search, advanced search.
Advanced search. You just came through at the end there. We're staying over here. What are you doing over there?
Reading reviews.
Reading reviews. This is easy. This side's great. All right. Oh, buying books. Up the front.
Checking my order status.
Oh, isn't that excellent? Fantastic. So you're an impulsive buyer. You've just bought something really new and exciting, which is a book. And you're going and you're checking the order status. You want to know exactly where it is. Yeah. Where's my book? But what about we're going in there and we're looking at the returns policy. We're going in there and think about some of the different usage patterns that impact the server. We're thinking about buying some music and we're listening to 30-second snippets of the music. Think about what that looks in terms of the different traffic perspective, the different load on the server. Buying books is okay. If someone had said buying a Kindle book, that's a bit different. So electronic delivery of these things. Someone said, Ah, perfect, excellent. Updating your credit card details, changing your shipping address. You're going in there and having a look at, you're reading, do we have reading reviews? Did I have that?
Yeah.
Excellent. What about writing reviews? Going in there and putting those details in. And guys, we could spend another 20 minutes going through what's happening there. Now, you're all reasonably honest, uncreative people, and oh, nasty on a Val afternoon. So, you're all honest people, but you know what? The world's not full of honest people. I'd say about 8% of all traffic across that site are people trying to do, you know, some form of hack against it, trying to do cross-site scripting, trying to do, you know, all these sorts of things. I'm not very creative when it comes to evil things. The persona, Evil Eric, as they are known within Amazon, is that type of traffic where people are going in there and trying to, you know, piggyback onto existing sessions, brute force passwords, all those sorts of things. So that's real traffic.
Skimming prices.
Skimming prices. Cool. Excellent. Excellent. So that's another typical example of something going on all the time. This is a hard site. In order for us to do some capacity planning, in order for us to replicate a typical 10 minutes in the life of Amazon, we've got to do all of those things, but they're not all represented equally. So, you know, browsing for books, okay, let's go, that's 50%, probably less. Let's go purchasing, well, that's going to also change seasonally. There'll be specials. This is hard stuff. So, while that recording seemed nice and easy, I think it was, going in there with the background knowledge to create these load patterns, to have a very good understanding of what users are doing on the system, that's some skill and talent right there. So I'm going to cheat, well not cheat, I'm not going to go and record 30, 50 different ways to use my music store app. I think two's enough. So how about we go with browsing for a record, and see what happens when I stand on that side. And we're also going to have a look at going in there and buying as well. That'll be more than enough for us. So I'll go and create a second one. So our recordings, what are you doing? Stop it. Okay. So I've done my recording. I can go in here and have a look at some of the information that's there. I'll give you a look at this in a moment. How about I just go ahead and save that? We'll go and rename it. I'll call that one browsing. It's a simple browse test. And I'm going to want to create another one. So let's go in there and add another web perf test. Go away. Go to the same site. But this time we're going to go and buy. So I'm going to go in there and let's go into classical. Pick this one. Pop that one into the cart. I'll go into alternative, whatever that is. Add that to the cart. And actually, that's enough. Another one of the things that you've got to think about is think times. So I went through that incredibly quickly. Do you think that is truly representative of a purchasing experience? Click that one, beauty, buy. It could be if it's shiny gadgets. But normally, you've got this think. We need to open up a page. We need to register what's on the page. We need to have a look at it. If it's a page of reviews, well, I'll probably start reading and scrolling and reading and scrolling, and nothing's going back to the server. There's no impact whatsoever on the server. So there's yet again another variable there for us to consider. Probably about the best bet there is to go through that experience as best as you think would be a typical experience, and then play it back with statistical plus or minus over that standard curve. So the tool will do that, but that's way too deep for this particular session. So recording your think times is also something that you've got to be considerate of. Not in my example, we don't need to worry too much about that. Okay, so let's have a closer look at this one. I might go ahead and save it. Guys, if you've got questions, just feel free to call them out as well. It feels like a Friday afternoon, even though it's Thursday. We can be casual. I'm going to pop down here, rename that one, and we'll call it buying. I better spell it right, given that I'm up on the stage. All right. If we have a closer look here, you can go in and see my query string parameters. We've got some information being passed across through the HTTP headers. Okay, we've got that header still passing across there. Query string parameter. We can go and have a look at these things. Yes, sir?
Does the recorder pick up XML HTTP requests?
Yes, it does. Okay. Any traffic back and forward from the server. So that should work just fine for you. Okay. Another question I usually get around the same thing, does it deal with all the JavaScript and things happening client-side? Well, no, because we don't care about that. Whatever's happening on the client doesn't have any bearing until we choose to submit the results back to the server. So again, that wasn't your question, but that's probably the two questions I tend to get at that point pretty frequently. All right. Yes, go, sir.
Is there any impact about using async server side when you actually do
those? Is there any impact? Well, there's no impact, but again, if it's traffic backwards and forwards from the server, we need to record that so that can be included in that playback experience, because that represents real load going to the server. So that's absolutely captured. If you have a look up there, we've got some details. So I can also data bind this. I mean, the site that I'm using there is a sample site. We're not going to data bind anything on it. But if I go and have a look at, genre equals classical, not the best bet there for me. But if I pop down here, you can see my value. I can go down here and add a data source. So I could go and data bind these. I can say that I want to go and run, 100 different customer details through the system. I can put whatever values that I want to do in here. So that's actually a reasonably straightforward and easy process. Pointing that data source, so if I click add data source, going and pointing it to the database, to a CSV, an XML file, that's a nice GUI experience, so pretty easy for us. All right, so I won't go in and have a look too much at that. What else do I really need to show there? Something I will look at across the top here. Firstly, if I want to go and run this test, so a simple buy test, I'm just going to click there, say run, and what's it going to do? Well, it's going to go and generate that load. It's going to send those same requests back against my server, and the data comes back. You're going to see some HTTP 200s, our OK, so the pages are all good. You're going to see the rendering in the browser here, but that's just showing us what's on the screen at the time. Remember, on playback, we're not using a browser. And in fact, I'll show you that by showing you the code version of exactly what's happening here. This is all about pushing the load to the server so that we can look at the impact and what's happening. You can see up there that we've got some information about the response times. We can have a look at the size of the data moving backwards and forwards. I can expand these things out. And when we made this request, here's the components that came back, a placeholder, some JavaScript, a CSS file. We can look at comparative sizes of those different things. So we're getting a lot of that information back. Yes, sir?
If we extract this from the IIS log, that would be the best load generation scenario.
Can I
take a snippet of the IIS log, 10 minutes, and that's where 10 minutes of hours.
I agree, but I don't believe you can. And the problem with doing what you're talking about there is then, because you're taking effectively that recording, we're losing a lot of ability to go and make changes here. So when I use this in a certain load pattern and data drive it, I understand exactly what you're saying there. It seems plausible. So I guess in the absence of being able to import it, certainly referring to it to get a good understanding of what we need to do would be absolutely invaluable. I like the import though. All right. So if we have a look here, we can have a look at the request. So the information going across to the server. Oops, click on it properly. We can see some information of exactly what's going over to the server. I can have a look at the response. I can see the response string, what came back. I can have a look at some context variables there. I can go across here and have a look at the response URL. We're making sure we're getting back the page we thought we were. And I can go and add extraction rules. I can add validation rules to the process. Not so much when we're using it to drive load, but what's very helpful there I've found is things like a validation rule. Right-click add validation rule. I can include things like time. Or I can say that I want to find this text on the page, or this HTML tag on the page, or I don't want to find those things. One of the challenges is if we go to amazon.com/anthony.html, what's going to happen? Am I going to get a nasty 404 horrible message? Well, I hope not. And I hope not on any of your sites as well. What I'm going to get is a correctly, successfully rendered page saying that doesn't exist, or it's going to go and do a search for Anthony as an author or a book title and say, look, is this what you were looking for? It should be more helpful for me. Now, the challenge there is if the page was renamed or the page no longer exists, we don't necessarily see the nasty 404. We could get a static page saying, sorry, there seems to be a problem. And that page is tiny. Now, we don't know. We're running these tests over and over again, and all of a sudden, they're so much more responsive. Excellent. Good work, Clint. You must have programmed that page up a treat. When, in fact, we're just hiding. See what happens when I know your name? It's bad. It's hiding a really nasty problem. So putting some validation rules in there, if we have certain text on that friendly 404 page, then we can make sure that we're not receiving that. And that's really nice just to make sure that those pages are what we expect they're going to be. We won't dig into that detail. What I will do is I'm going to go in, close out of here. How about we go and have a look at some of these other options here? Firstly, I can set some credentials. I can also data bind those credentials. So if there is some form of authentication on your sites, that can be dealt with as well. I can go up here and add some plugins. So I can really extend on this any way I like. I can write some code there, I can create some variables, I can do some logic, I can retrieve things from the database and push that into the tests later on for maintainability if I wanted to do that. I'm going to go in here and let's parameterize the web server. So often where I record the test is not where I want to run it. If you have a look here, demomusicstore.cloudapp.net is hard-coded into every single line there. So I'm going to choose to go and parameterize that. And of course, the logical thing there is going to be extract the server part of the URL out. And instead, I'm going to have a little parameter called web server 1. When I click on OK there, it's pulled out that server name, put in a parameter in its place, and the parameter is added down the bottom. So now I can go and data bind that. If I want to go and drive load, I can go through, say, a network load balancer. I could go around a network load balancer and simply data bind that, and I can control it. Okay, so I can say, what happens if the load balancer is not quite doing its job right, if 90% of the load goes to one member of the farm instead of the rest? So it's not evenly balanced, what goes on? So there's lots of different scenarios that can be supported there. I'm going to go up here and save that, and while I think of it, I'll pop across to browsing and do the same thing. Just go and parameterize both of those. The next thing I want to do is I wanted to show you the code. So I'll choose the browsing just because it's open at the moment. I'll say convert that into a coded test. just so that if you've never seen what goes on, you can now. So it grabs that, turns it into code, and okay, so there's where our parameters set. Let's have a look at one of these guys here. Let's try clicking that properly. That's a little easier. So effectively what we do is we're using a network class. We're instantiating an instance of that. We're giving it the URL. In this particular example, we've got a think time. So this is the one where I was talking a lot as we went. So the think time here is 30, 35 seconds. You'll see that we're going in and we're adding a value to the headers collection. So there's a referrer ID got to go across. And then in the query string parameters collection, we're sending across genre equals disco. We go and make the request. And what do we do with what we get back? Mark, what do we do with what we get back?
Nothing.
Nothing. We throw it away. Good answer. See, two people's names that I know in the room. So, you're next up the back, Grant. So, if you have a look there, this is all about generating that load. You know, we don't do anything with the data that comes back. If we set up validation rules or extraction rules, then you'll see a little bit more activity going on there. Can you extend this? Well, of course, it's just code now. So if there is anything interesting or funky you want to do, write the code to do it. For now, I'll simply save it, and that'll represent, you know, a kind of third test, even though, of course, it's identical to one that already exists. So I've created some web tests. Question? Yes, sir. So they're considered to be two. So if you look across in my Solution Explorer, can you see that? I can zoom in on it. If I can get my zoom working, come on. There we go. So what you see here is I've got my browsing test. That's the one I recorded. And then I created the coded one, which is immediately below it. So for all intents and purposes, it thinks that it's two tests. But clearly they do absolutely identical things. Once it's code, I can't go back to the nice friendly screen. So if I've got coding skills, I'd probably prefer it to be in code. But for the ease of things like data binding and so forth, having that non-coded version is probably better for a non-coder. Okay, did that answer the question?
Sure.
Yeah? Okay. Another one, sure. Okay. So basically, in terms of the question there, often subsequent requests depend on what's happened in the first request or an earlier one. So we've got some choices there. Firstly, you can data, I mean, I'm not going to, there's a few different ways of addressing that. Firstly, I can use extraction rules. So based on the result in one test, I can pull something out programmatically and use that later if I wish. I can go and do things like data bind it. So I can put values in a database and sort of drive it that way. I can pull information out through code, choose to store that in a data table that I can then read in a subsequent test. So there are some choices there. It really just depends on the details of the scenario you're talking about.
But manually you need to change, implement something. It's not just capture the screen or run the page or something.
It depends on how autonomous those tests are. I mean, the example you gave me is you do something up here and then in another test later. I mean, if they are sort of arm's length apart, there's got to be some form of persistence happening, which is why I said you'd probably manually pull it out, stick it in a database, and then reuse it on a subsequent test. If it's something that we can do within the same test, well, that's a lot easier. We can just keep values in memory between them. So, I mean, I guess they're the choices that are sticking out there. Putting some web test plugins there also gives me a lot of flexibility with how I deal with that. Okay. Yes, sir.
Can you schedule these tests to sort of go and run at a particular time?
Yes. So that's like the cut and burn approach. Let's get a load test happening when I'm not at work tomorrow. Yeah, I like that. So all of these things can be driven by the command line. So if you can get it on the command line, you can use any form of scheduling tool that you want to possibly use.
My question is regarding the think time. Well, you have 20
No.
So, what's the
question? In terms of the licensing, why do we get... So, not only do you give me the book questions, you give me the licensing questions over here? Really?
The question was actually, well, that's the beginning of it. That's the tip of it.
It gets worse.
Yeah, the problem is actually, let's say, for example, we have a limited number of customers, potential clients that
sure.
we can use for doing the load testing. And so some issues on the server side, depend on the thinking time, actually. For example, if you give it enough time, then, the server will catch up, and then you have enough time to, release the resources. Mm-hmm. But if you just, keep, sending requests, with a little bit of shorter thinking time, then you probably, that wouldn't be a realistic,
Sure.
Even the limitation that we have, the number of users that can currently be the server.
So let me try and answer both of those. So there was I'm not going to try and repeat all of that because I know I'm going to get it wrong. But the key things there, my take from that. Firstly, Visual Studio Ultimate does not give you a limited number of user licenses. I believe they changed that in 2012. It used to be a per processor. Then they tried to do something a little bit different. And then they said, that's really bad. So I believe now that the licensing with Ultimate is that you can have unlimited number of users that you can generate on that particular machine.
So that solves the whole problem.
So that solves a lot of it. And of course, go talk to the guys down in the dev den, talk to someone like Arabind. He'd be able to answer that absolutely. Or there's a licensing white paper. I'm not a licensing expert for sure. So the second, to answer the second part there, well, think time is also, it's just a parameter. So you can parameterize your think time. Programmatically, you can work out any algorithm you like to change your think times, to shrink them down, expand them out again. So it's just another variable you can play with in any way that you see fit.
But the challenge would be, doesn't matter, what value you choose for your thinking time.
Yep.
It's not, reflecting the reality.
So it's not reflecting the reality. So I guess that's why, so when you record the think time, and we'll turn this into a load test, we'll have a closer look at this. With your think time, if we can play it back, if we record at this and play it back with a plus minus around that, that's about the best we can do. Use statistical inference to come up with, what we would like to believe is typical. So typical with some outliers. Yeah? All right. So I've got a couple of web tests there. What I'm going to do is right-click on that, and let's go and turn it into a load test. So load test's interesting. Guess what? It's a wizard. Nice and easy. So I'm going to go ahead and say next. And what sort of scenario do I want here? I'm going to say it's a light constant load. So, a very, very clear descriptive thing. I want reasonably light. I don't want to overpower anything at all. I want to keep the load constant. So I'm looking for things that vary on my server when the load doesn't change. Is my memory gradually increasing? Are my page response times gradually increasing when I've got a constant load? I could also go in there and say that I want a light stepped load. So let's just go and add 10 users every 10 seconds. And let's see what performance counters have a direct linear relationship with that. Is my memory stepping up? So do I have a tightly sessioned bound application? So I don't need to start looking at offloading some of that session off to a state server. There are some choices like that. I'm going to go in there and do I want to use the recorded think times? I think not, because I did a lot of talking. Do I want to do a normal distribution around there? Or don't use think times, just go hard. Do I want to go in there and specify a certain amount of time to elapse between iterations of a given test? So lots of knobs and dials I can change. I'll go ahead with a constant load, and I'm going to say that I want 25 concurrent virtual users. I'll say next. In terms of the load pattern, if I say that I want 75% of this test, so 75% browsing, 25% buying, how do I want to do that? Do I want to go browse, buy, browse, and so on? Or do I want to do all of the more common ones as a block? In terms of the tests that I want, I can go in there and say, and guess who didn't actually build his solution, so he doesn't get the coded one? We can work with two. I'm going to go in there and choose the tests that I want. Now, that could be a large number of tests to get a reasonably accurate load. In terms of browsing and buying, there's going to be typically a lot more browsing than buying. But that may change as we approach traditional gift-giving seasons. So as we come to, Christmas at the end of the year, we might have to rerun these and just tweak it a little bit more because we have more purchasing occurring at that time. The network. So I've got to go in here and say, well, look, in terms of the latency, in terms of the load, am I sort of dribbling it out over a modem? Wasn't it great to hear the modem during the kickoff on Monday or Tuesday afternoon? Sarcasm. We don't tend to have a lot of users coming in via the LAN. So let's go in here and say, well, look, mobile's really, really popular. Most of our connections are going to be 3G. So simulate the load pattern there. I don't have the right virtual NIC installed to allow me to do that for the demo, so I will have to go back for now. What browsers? Well, we all know that IE rocks. No one uses Chrome. I can't even push Firefox down now. All right. Why are we doing that? Hang on. Let's go and put in IE 10. All right, what do you reckon? Can you install IE 9 and 10 on the server at the same time? Say it again. Who said that? Excellent. So all we're doing there is we're just changing the user agent string and the HTTP header that goes across. If your web server, if your site doesn't do anything different based on the agent string, changing this doesn't make any difference at all. And in a lot of cases, IE 9 and 10, is there a difference there that would affect the server in any way? Perhaps, perhaps not. So it's more generational, I would have thought, than exact version numbers. Okay, so there's some patterns in there. Again, just keep it simple for now. And then what information do I want to get back? Now, this is the really interesting thing. We're generating the load not just for the excitement of generating the load. That's, really just the first part. We want to then measure and look at the effect on the server infrastructure itself. So what are we going to collect? We're going to collect our perfmon counters. Okay, so what's happening with memory, what's happening with disk, what's happening with CPU, what's happening with SQL, the SQL counters, with IIS, the .NET counters, all those sorts of things. That's a lot of data. And where do I want to collect that from? So I could have a couple of clustered web front ends, I could have some mid-tier app servers, I can have some SQL boxes over here. So maybe I need to go and add quite a few more. I'll say next and finish. Whoops. Trying to remember really hard what that last screen was. Don't you hate it when you do that click fest? Can't remember what the last screen was. You know what? Let's just take the default values and see what it was. I think it was something really, okay. Feeling really embarrassed right now. Run settings, actually that was a significant thing. In terms of my run settings, okay, so I've chosen to go with, I really should show you that properly. Wish I hadn't done that click fest. So let's try that again. Add load test. Fortunately, it's a wizard and I haven't got to explain it now. Lighter constant load. Standard distribution, 24. It's lighter. We'll do that one. We'll go and add two tests. All right, click next. We're coming in from the LAN, IE is fine. Slowing down the clicking now. So this is interesting. So as nervous as I am about going out to the audience, particularly on this side of the room, I have a question. You yawned in my session. You just said, pick me. Would you prefer, you want a really good responsive experience, we've got a great big server over here, would you like to be the only user on the system or the 101st? 50-50.
Only the 100.
The 101st? Mm. Okay, 50-50 and you did pick the third one, but 101st, fine. And it was the correct answer. The worst experience is usually the first user. You've got no benefit of what's happening in the cache, our objects aren't spinning, things aren't happening in memory, so the first user experience is usually the worst. And that's going to skew the values. So what we'd rather do is let's have some warm-up times. Let's just throw some of these tests at the server and not start collecting any data. Let's get things into memory. Let's make things move, spin up, and then start driving the load and capturing the results. So you got it right. This is a good one too. Okay. Most people don't. Most people say, I want the server all to myself. So what I'm going to do there is I'm going to say, do we want some warm-up time? Yeah, let's have. We warm up really quickly, 5 seconds. And in terms of running my test, I'm going to go ahead and run it for just a minute. Sampling rate, I'm happy with the rest of that stuff there. Got my web load test, and I'm just going to go ahead and run it. And I will save it because I'm just that kind of guy sometimes. Run. Okay, so what we're going to see over the minute is we're doing some warm-up, and we're going to go and start collecting this wealth of information. We're going to have a look at, you know, we're going to grab information from disk, we're going to grab the CPU, we're going to see CPU load, we're going to capture it based on percent of user time versus percent of system time. We're going to have a look at page times, so average page time, we're going to look at any errors that are occurring there, we're going to look at, we've got some built-in thresholds, so CPU above, I think it's 90%, it's going to be a threshold violation. We've got some default values there on page response times, which is either 2 or 3 seconds. Now, this is running in a virtual machine on a laptop, so you're going to see some interesting, colourful things up there. You would not do this type of testing whatsoever. Yes, sir? No. So what we so that's an excellent question. So what you see here is just Visual Studio Ultimate. So I'm using the controller and agent built into Ultimate on this occasion. We can go and put the controller on a separate machine. We can go and put as many agents as we want out there. We do need to then have, we need to be running the test in a security context that lets us access those machines and pull the counter the performance data in. But the components needed to do that is built in to the OS for us. Okay, but... No, no. Okay. Because technically that web app is sitting up in the Azure cloud somewhere. I can't install anything on it. There was another question, was there? Yes, sir. Oh. So remember that really, really busy slide at the very beginning there that had lots of color and text that you simply could not have read from the back of the room? I threw that up on the screen to show that, yeah, this is all Ultimate. Yeah. I wanted to be like I told you so, but then I realized that the font would have been about that big for you, so I'll let you get away with that. Okay, so it's gone and done this collection of information for us. It's going, it can identify our fastest, our slowest pages. It can give us a hit list of where we need to go and look at improving. There's just not a lot of things going on there that makes that data overly interesting for us in this occasion. But I can switch up here and have a look at the graphs. I can do a consolidated zoom. What was happening around about here? And these other graphs showing my page response times, showing what's happening on the controller and agent, also zoom in at the same time. So that's all well and good. I can go and expand out my details over here. I can have a look at the average test time. There's just too much there to go through and talk about right now. What's happening with memory, committed bytes in use. I can do a control H, highlight that. Wrong keyboard shortcut. I thought I was going to go and highlight that on one of the charts. I can pick it up and go and drop it onto one of these charts very easily. I can go up the top here and have a look at that tabular information. I can go in and dig into the details. I can get a visualization of what all those virtual users were doing. If I did get a threshold violation or an error occur, I can see exactly what one of my virtual users was doing at the time. I could see that all of the errors happened at exactly the same time. So it's not something likely to be driven by the user, but more likely some form of system error or issue. So there's plenty more there. But we won't go into that right now. Yes, sir?
Just curious, the performance counters, are they from the virtual machine for the user?
No. So these counters, the challenge that we see here is it's on my machine, it's everything sits together. The counters that we really want to see here are going to be the counters that are coming in from where the application's running, so our web servers and those kinds of things.
In this particular test, though, you're executing the test on your laptop.
Yes.
It's actually hitting over the web to HTTP.
It is, yes. So I am gracefully faking one part of that. So we are looking at agent details, and I am cheating. Thank you, Mark.
Well, that's not my intention of the question.
I know.
If you're so in a normal environment, like you'd want to test on an environment that at least is similar to your infrastructure in your lab.
Yeah.
So what do you actually have to do on the web server that you're testing to then get the performance counters?
Okay. So, wow, what a question. So there's two ways of answering that. If it is something that we self-host, if we have full control of that, one of the things that we can do is we, you know, to really do this with the ultimate degrees of accuracy, you want to have a dedicated, isolated network. You know, so the likelihood of being able to easily get that in any corporate environment, like a truly isolated network, zero. Although I have worked with customers, I worked with a customer in Brisbane that had to simulate 100,000 virtual users. And they never quite got there. They got to 97,000. It took 50 agent machines to do it. And at that point, they had to keep scaling up the controller box because you can only have one single controller. And the controller just couldn't handle it. Agents just disappeared around that threshold mark. And that was fine. The customer said, look, that's just not a problem. But that's 50 machines generating load. It was extraordinary. So if you think about all those counters coming in, and they did this on an isolated network. So you can then look at putting the agent in different places. So if you can get the agent close to the machine, that's going to reduce the points of variance that exist. So in other words, if I've got my controller here, my servers are up on the 10th floor in a server room, if I can go and put an agent as close to that machine as I can, I'm removing that variance between them. That agent can then talk to the machine, collect the information, pass it back to the controller, and then the controller can store that typically in a local SQL database. You're looking at about 10 gig of data for every 24 hours of load testing, so you've got to think about that for scalability. Also means that SQL Express isn't a good option. Not when you're collecting that amount of information, okay? And I'll show you when we actually, the very next thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go and do this for when I hit the cloud, and you'll see that it does all of this for us. Sleight of hand and magic. Okay, I'm gonna leave there for now. How are we going for time? Okay, so what I wanna do then is move into, let's say that's it for that one. Switch. So to recap that, you've got to configure your test environment. Okay, that's one of the biggest challenges, getting the machines rolled out, getting the agents installed, getting them connected to the controller, and so on. You've got to author the tests, run the tests, analyze the results, fix the performance and scale problems, and go and rerun the tests. So I had an opportunity there to rerun that test, and one of the things that I didn't show you, and I'm being mindful of your time and getting you out to those buses, was in the toolbar, there was an Excel icon. So you can basically say, I want to report on this in Excel. It'll open that data in Excel. I really wanted to show you that. It'll open the data in Excel, and you can say, now I want to open another one. So you've got your baseline. You can then open the next one, and it plots and graphs for you in Excel the differences. So for example, you get your baseline, you make some changes, you deploy those changes, you rerun the tests, and it shows you if you are getting better or worse. So it takes a lot of that out of the equation and does that graphically. At the end of the day, at the end of the session, if you wanted to just hang back and see that, I will show that to you, but I just don't want to overrun on party night. That would be very bad.
That's a quick question.
Please.
In terms of running the test, right, can you have it users role specific? So, you know, sometimes you have different roles.
Sure.
And do people see different information depending upon what roles they belong to?
Yes. Yes, so in terms of, so really what you're talking about is authentication.
Yeah.
So I could go in there and I could data bind the authentication, the credentials that were being passed across to the web application. So I can go in there and use a user credential that puts them in the storefront role,
yeah,
who has a certain experience versus the stockman role or the manager role. So again, just by using different users when I drive this and using role-based authentication there, I can do that, yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, so we've done all those things. I had to cheat down there towards the bottom in the interest of time, but let's have a look at cloud-powered load testing. Slide and demo. No, but I was bored with slides there, you can tell. So I'll switch back here. I want to go and drive this load in the cloud. The big challenge there of going and buying the servers, scaling those servers out, getting them provisioned, getting them acquired from the vendor and so forth. Let's see if we can do something about it. So today, in order to be able to do that, I'm going to go into my Team Explorer and I'm going to connect to a Team Foundation service account. Now remember, at the moment these are free, well, always going to be free for up to 5 users. And after that, of course, as part of your MSDN subscriptions, you're going to have these accounts. So they're pretty available sorts of things. And that's not the one I want to go to. I want to go to the cloud one. How many people have accounts on this already? Oh, that's awesome. Excellent. So all I need to do is simply go in there and establish the connection. Once the connection is established, then at the moment, I think every user gets 20,000 virtual user minutes a month for free. By signing up for the early adopter program, they increase that to 200,000 virtual user minutes per month free. Okay, it's in preview, it'll be in preview, who knows how long that's going to be. And then presumably there'll be a bundled amount of virtual user minutes included with your MSDN. And then in extreme cases where you want more, then there'll just be a fee for those extra minutes each month. Okay, that's what I expect to see there. There's been no announcements. It's very early days for the load testing service. Okay, so I'm going to switch back here now. How can I make all of these things work in the cloud? So I've established that connection. I'm going to go back to my Solution Explorer. And don't blink. I'm going to go into my load test settings file. Would you like to run them with the service? Yes, please. Apply. Close. Done. Let's go and run it. So I'll go back to my load test. The experience is different. So what we're going to do there is we're going to go up to the cloud. We're going to send the test data up to the controller in the cloud. The controller in the cloud is going to go and find an agent from the available pool of agents for me. It's then going to run that load test, and I forgot to do something. I'm pretty sure I forgot to set the web server parameter and the load test. We'll see how that one goes. There may have been one step I missed. That's complacent and exciting because I was just trying to show off. Look, it's one click. It was two. So in view the status messages there, that will report for me how many minutes I've got available, how many virtual user minutes. But apart from that, it's going to come up with a slightly different visual experience as it goes and drives this load from machines sitting up in Azure. It's going to show me not quite the same amount of data that you saw before, not in this view. We might get some interesting things being graphed there, so we do our little warm-up. And it's going to break it down into performance and throughput for me. So we did our little warm-up. I can switch across and see what's happening with our throughput. And these have been improved. Remember, this is the preview version of this. So when you see RC or potentially RTM, these are a lot more responsive. These ones do tend to have to catch up and draw segments every now and again. But you see, they're just doing this with absolute no load whatsoever. So driving 24 concurrent virtual users from one of the Azure hosts doesn't raise a sweat at all. So let's have a look at what happens when that load test is finished. So the load test will complete. Excuse me. and it's going to allow me to download the report information. Collecting the results for me. I want to download the report. So it's going to pull down the rich data from the cloud, and then I'm going to say that I wish to view that report. And do you recognize that? What do you think? Driving the load from the cloud. So of course, one of the big benefits of the cloud is what? The elasticity of the cloud. So wouldn't it be really interesting if I could get out of here, pop back over there, go back to my load test, and let's go to the run settings, view properties for the run settings. I'm going to pop over here, and one of the first things I've got here is my agent count. Zero says automatically give me the agents that I need. So this one, I'll tell you in advance. The acquisition of these agents will take time. So we may not, in the interests of getting you out of here on time, see the end result, but you should see it getting very close. I was going to be really flamboyant and go and drive a significant load there with lots of agents. I'll try and go with just two, and you may see a result before we wrap up. So I'm going to go ahead with two agents. So it's going to spin up two agents in the cloud to drive the demand and the load. And let's go and find our load pattern. And instead of 24 concurrent virtual users, so tempting to hit it again. Let's go with 2,400. They are my minutes, I do use them. So I've increased the load there and scaled that out. It can only break really, can't it? Let's be a little bit flippant with it and see what happens. And let's go and run that load test now. And that's where one of the real, nice features of this comes in. The fact that I can scale from 24 to 10,000 just by changing those things. There will eventually be some form of cost. You'll get a certain number of those minutes made available to you each month. And if you want to go into some bigger numbers, you can. At the moment, it is using a fixed number of agents in a pool during preview. So what that means is while it's in preview, it's completely free. If other people are using those agents, it may pause on acquiring resources for minutes at a time. When I did this earlier today, I was acquiring four agents, and I think it probably went the vicinity of about 6 minutes before it would free enough of those up for me to use. So that could just take a little bit longer. Okay, so we'll let that go. Your hand was first. So what we can see right now in the preview release is somewhat limited. The short answer is yes, you will. So when I was doing the test earlier with four, I managed to get one of the agents up to about 90% CPU, which showed a threshold violation for me. So yes, those counters, we will start to see more of those things happening. Okay, so. I do not know that. I can't believe that they would charge you for the data on top of this. I think that would need to be covered in the service offering. So I don't think it should be data, but I honestly don't know. They'll have to tell us that. Right now, we don't have the ability to change geos. We're hoping to see that by RTM. So right now, presumably, this is popping out of a data center around Chicago is my guess, but it's purely a guess and speculation. Yes. So I had one called Busy Bakery, which was sitting on one of my Azure websites using my credits up, and I thought, this is a bad idea. Yep. So I was having fun putting in big numbers, thinking, ooh, I'm using up all my credit there. So this is one that Microsoft Anu set up. So that's good. I can hammer that one pretty hard. If you are doing this with an on-premise, you will need access to that site from the Azure cloud. So you'll need to poke a hole in the firewall, but they can give you the range of addresses where that load will come from. So you can be very selective on your endpoints that you're going to allow through that firewall. Sir, another question.
Would you want to run the load
entirely up to you. So do you anticipate the demand on that site to come from geographically that location? When we see the RTM, I'm hoping we're going to be able to choose which geography. I want to be able to see another thing in the wizard where I say, look, I want 50% of people from the APAC region, I want 25% from Europe and 25% from North America. It'd be great to be able to then go and do that, so you'll be able to choose where that load's going to be generated from, is what I expect in terms of the roadmap of the service. Another one, go. I think it's all of those things. I mean, in terms of delivering a quality service, you want to have a really good, compelling story for your end users, and to deliver that, well, you've got to make sure you've got the hardware resources to back that up. So I think it's really all of those things. And it's not just a case of building the tests that you've seen there, it's the whole mix of them. You know, are we going to have exclusive rights to a particular song coming out next month? So we're just going to be and then just peek through the roof. So it's quite a discipline to do good load testing. Guys, I am mindful that we're due to finish in 3 minutes. One more.
Have you come across any user or agent limits?
User or agent limits, yes. So I guess the most significant one was that example where we were trying to hit the 100,000 with on-premise. It's too early to say up here because, again, we're constrained by the pool I make available during the free preview. So I think if I went above 4, it probably would have just said no. In this particular, with this account.
What's the highest number of users you've used before?
20,000, yeah. Again, that's just preview. That's just choosing not to burn all my user minutes in a particular demonstration. Guys, we're not going to see that one fly. I don't want to hold anyone else up, but if you did want to just sit there and see it start, what you will see is the same experience. You'll see bars going across the screen, and what you're going to see is a little peak interesting at the front probably, but then you're going to find for generating 10,000 concurrent virtual users, where that site's hosted on the Azure Web Services, it shouldn't cause a problem for us at all. We will see some CPU violations is what I expect to see, because I think I only went with two agents. So two agents, 10,000, that should push the agents pretty hard, is my guess. So thank you very much for coming along for the last session of the day. There's the slides that you can have a look at. There's some information about some other sessions and those sorts of details. I'm really supposed to show you that, but I'd love to see this thing move forward. I'll do these ones really quick and then get back and you can look over your shoulder as you leave. So basically, in terms of driving this from the cloud, it was actually really, really simple at the end there. I spent most of the session showing you what's there today. You can go and use this. We switched across into 2013. We saw that really it was just a case of going into the test settings file and choosing the little box down the bottom. You did need to have that account that most of you have on the hosted service, and then just driving that load was reasonably straightforward. So they've taken out one of the most difficult parts of doing that load testing. There's some content there if you wanted to download the slides and have a look, so still plenty of things to come with TechEd tomorrow for the final day. Oop, I'll bring that one back. Excellent, got it? Alrighty. And I'll probably hang out at DevDen tomorrow morning if anyone wants to come and ask any questions there. But apart from that, remember to fill in your evals. There's some nice little prizes and bits and pieces there. Enjoy yourselves at Movie World tonight, and I will switch back in case anyone wants to stay and have a look at that. Thanks a lot. Look, it's warming up. It's going to happen.
Zero accounts and stuff sorted out.
Excellent. Yeah.